drastically coming down. So the online lectures are not probably liked by you or attended by you, but I'm telling you a number of times that this is going to be your attendance for the university, and unless you maintain minimum attendance, you cannot appear for the examination. Today's topic is renal calculus disease. So why should you know about the calculi? Calculi is incidence is increasing, and it is present in many organs. Gallstones are there, pancreatic calculi are there, even prepucial calculi can be there, vesical calculus, uterine calculus. All these things are important not only anatomically but also functionally by the effect they produce on the organs. And I told you in the beginning, the Hippocrates himself said, I will not cut down on stone, I will leave it to the specialists. So renal calculus disease or operations on kidney stones been recognized as a specialty even from the types of Hippocrates. Now this renal calculus disease is on the increase due to changes in dietary habits, fluid consumption, hot climate, and other reasons. And people living in hot climates are more prone for this. We'll see why it is so. And another important thing which has happened in management of calculus disease is an explosion of equipment and energy sources. This has drastically changed the management of the renal calculus disease. From the times when we were students, we were doing all open operations. Now everything is done with endoscopy, robotic surgery, laparoscopic surgery, and the whole laser, introduction of laser in the management of calculi has brought a wonderful change. Still, renal calculus disease is a formidable problem because it can produce sepsis and death, renal failure in many of the people. So we have to be treated at the earliest. And some are recurrent stone formers. You remove one stone, another stone forms. Most of the times we do a lot of investigations, but we are unable to pinpoint a reason. The only advice we give them is take plenty of water fluids, at least 3 to 4 liters per day. More so after you take food, 1 hour after food, and in the night time also. So many things, dietary advices are all given to these patients. So let us go into the topic first. So renal calculus disease, right? Let us discuss about the etiology of the renal calculus disease. There are so many causes which are presumed, but we cannot pinpoint to one reason as a cause for stone formation. It is multifactorial. Not only these things, there are certain promoters of calculus disease, certain inhibitors of calculus disease not naturally occurring in the body, and how a stone forms and grows, how to break down this cycle is a formidable thing. So one is dietetic. Deficiency of vitamin A produces desquamation of the epithelium, and there is a nidus for the stone formation. So deficiency of vitamin A. So previously, children were so ill-nourished that vesical calculus used to be a dominant disease in those poorly nourished children. The other one is altered urinary solutes and colloids. Dehydration increases the concentration of the stone-forming substances in the urine. Reduced colloids and mucoproteins, which chelate calcium, favor stone formation. Decreased urinary citrate. Citrate is one of the naturally occurring inhibitors. So this is decreased citrate causes calculi. This keeps the insoluble calcium phosphate in solution. Then renal infection. Renal infection, there is obstruction, there is urea spitting organism infection, which leads to calculi formation. So renal infection is a process of stone formation. Stone invites urinary infection. This is both sides. Inadequate urinary drainage and stasis. This is what I was talking about. If there is stasis, there is concentration of the urinary solutes in the urine. They get precipitated on a bacteria or something and then grow and produce stones. If there are multiple calculi in kidney or bladder or anywhere, you'll have to think about outflow obstruction, the pleuritic ejection obstruction in the case of kidney, and bladder neck obstruction or prostate obstruction in NRH. Prolonged immobilization demineralizes the bones. There is high calcium content in circulation and then stone formation. So this is more common in paraplegics who lie down in bed as spinal injury patients. Hyperparathyroidism, as you know, produces hypercalcemia and that in turn produces hypercalciuria. 5% of the patients with radiopaque stones are due to hyperparathyroidism. It is the thing which says they pass their skeletons in the urine. That means a lot of calcium is passed in the urine. So recurrent multiple calculi, you have to rule out this hyperparathyroidism. So what the treatment is, only removal of parathyroid adenomas if they are there, if they are identified. So as I was telling you, there are certain promoters of stone formation. Not everybody forms stones, right? Only few people form stones. And a person who formed stone once is prone for recurrent stone formation. So there must be some reasons for that. Low urine volume. Anything you excrete in the urine should be diluted. So you should take a lot of water, a lot of urine production should be there. If it is a concentrated urine, these have a tendency to precipitate and form stones. As I already discussed, hypercalciuria is one of the important reasons for stone formation. Hyperoxaluria occurs in some patients with metabolic defects and consumption of high oxalate containing diet or something. That also causes stone formation. Phosphaturia is another thing which causes stone formation. Urinary pH, you frequently see that alkaline citrate is prescribed to stone formation. So alkaline pH inhibits and acid pH promotes stone formation. Uric acid or urate in the urine also causes stone formation. There are, as I said, certain inhibitors of stone formation. Citrate present in the urine. Pyrophosphate, which inhibits both calcium oxalate and calcium phosphate crystallization. We'll see how a stone forms. All are crystals in the urine. How a stone forms, we'll see. A stone to form, there must be an iodous. Stones get precipitated, crystals get precipitated, they aggregate and then grow. These are the phases of stone formation. Phytate present in the vegetables is another inhibitor of stone formation. Magnesium is one thing which inhibits stone formation. It also occurs naturally. Alkaline pH, as I said, it inhibits stone formation. Tom Horsford protein, you know about physiology. It is an inhibitor of crystallization. It's an example of glycoproteins. So now we come to the mechanism of stone formation. We are talking about kidney, renal stone, because stone usually forms in the kidneys only, comes down the ureter and forms and goes into the bladder. Our bladder vesicle calculi can form primarily in the bladder itself. Usually it's a renal stone which comes down into the ureter to produce ureteric stone. And sometimes it comes down into the bladder also. The mechanism of stone formation includes nucleation of stone constituent crystals. So stone, as I was discussing, calcium, oxalate, urate, all these things are stone forming substances. When they are filtered in the urine, filtered in glomerular filtrate, it contains crystals that are excreted through the tubular system. This nucleation occurs and their growth and aggregation to a size that can interact with some intrarenal structures. These crystals, as I said, they aggregate to form a nidus and then they attach themselves to some intrarenal structure. This is called Randall's plaque, a submucosal plaque, wherein these crystals get attached and grow. This is one of the theories of calculi formation, how the stone gets attached to the structure. Later on, it can pierce the submucosa and get into the collecting system. Their retention within the kidney or renal collecting system and further aggregation and or secondary nucleation to form the clinical stone. Clinical stone forms with these crystals only. These crystals aggregate. There is always a matrix, which is a protein around which these stones form and grow. So calculi may contains a matrix and surrounded by crystal growth, aggregation of the crystals to a size that can form a stone. So this is how a stone forms, just doesn't form If there are crystals in urea, crystal urea, it need not form stones. If there is a lot of urine production by means of fluid intake, and there is no obstruction in the kidney anywhere, so for them to stop. So there is reduced output, concentration of the crystals, their aggregation to grow as a stone to a critical size to form a stone occurs in favorable conditions. Then we come to types of renal calculi. There are many types of renal calculi. Important things are oxalate calculus, which is irregular. Calculus is irregular, as you are seeing here, with multiple sharp projections. So the oxalate calculi produces hematuria. Surface is discolored with altered blood. Calcium oxalate monohydrate stones are very hard and radiolucent. All these stones can be radio opaque or radiolucent. Most 70% of the stones are radio opaque. Only 30% are radiolucent, which we may find difficult to diagnose on an X-ray KAB. But 70% are radiolucent in X-ray. The other type is a phosphate calculus. Calcium, ammonium, magnesium phosphate is called Struvite calculus. This happens more in infective stones. There is infection. Smooth, dirty white stones, clearly seen on X-ray because they are radiolucent, radio-opaque. It grows in alkaline urine and infected with proteus species. This is a very common occurrence in staghorn calculi, which, what is staghorn, will come later. The staghorn calculus with proteus infection, the triple phosphate crystals, calcium phosphate, magnesium phosphate, and ammonium phosphate, these are called triple phosphate stones. The large stone filling most of the collecting system is called a staghorn calculus because it resembles the horns of a stag. You see, primary division and secondary division is there for the collecting system. Major calluses and minor calluses. So that resembles a stag horn. That's why it's called stag horn calculus. This type of calculi may not produce any significant symptoms. It may be there for long before they're diagnosed because of the investigation done for some other condition. Because of hematuria or urinary tract infection, or sometimes bilateral staghorn calculi can present with renal failure also. So this is how the staghorn calculus is. In an IVP, it just resembles that is an IVP, picture-like thing. So this is a staghorn calculus. The other calculate is a uric acid or urate calculi. Uric acid calculus is radiolucent. Pure uric acid calculus is radiolucent. You cannot see in plain X-ray. Need to depend on other investigations. They are hard, smooth, and multiple. Yellow to reddish brown, multifaceted surface. Pure uric acid stones are radiolucent. How to diagnose that if they are radiolucent? One is an ultrasound. Then intravenous urogram, they appear like a filling defect. Suppose there is a calculus, uric acid calculus in renal pelvis, you do an IVP, you find a filling defect, it can be a tumor also. So then you have to differentiate it from other investigations like CT scan and other things. Children, mixed ammonium and sodium urate crystals are usually found, yellow, soft, and friable. As I said, all these uric acid urate calculi are radiolucent, unless they have some calcium content. Cysteine calculus is another stone which usually we don't see much. We see mainly phosphate calculi, uric acid, and oxalate calculi. This is uncommon, appear in patients with cystinuria, congenital metabolic defect. There's hexagonal translucent white crystals form only in acid urine. So these can be treated conservatively also sometimes by giving them alkalizing the urine, increasing the urine output by taking a lot of water. Often multiple form a cast of the collecting system. And yellow when removed, but become green because of the chemical changes that occur. Sulfur content gives some radiopacity and hardness. Xanthine calculi are rare. These are smooth and round, brick red in color. Show lamellation in cross-section. Multiple layers, lamellation is multiple layers. So how does a renal calculus present? We are talking about renal calculi now. Rest of the things we later. Renal calculi are the commonest cause of abdominal pain. It's a common cause. Whenever a patient presents with non-specific abdominal pain, if they are present with typical symptoms of renal calculi, it's okay. Any abdominal pain, which undiagnosed, cause not known, you take an ultrasound, you are likely to find renal calculi. This has created a phobia in patients because of frequent use of ultrasound. Even small stones are diagnosed, 5 mm calculi are also diagnosed. And the ultrasound, you say there are 5 mm calculi in upper, lower, middle calluses on both sides. People get frightened because they think they have stone disease which is going to kill them. It's not like that. All stones, some stones fall off on their own. So this has caused a awareness. Everybody wants an ultrasound now, right? We have to do it. Anyway, you have to do it if the pain abdomen is there and you cannot digest. Nearly 50% present between 30 to 40 years of age. That means most productive age, loss of working hours are possible when these renal calculi occur. Because when he has acute pain, he cannot work. Males predominate in renal calculi because they work and a lot of sweat and concentrated urine. They don't take fluid. That's why probably they are more in men. And as I told you, bilateral staghorn calculi can be silent. They can be presenting only late in the disease because of the urinary sepsis, hematuria, or sometimes renal failure, bilateral staghorn calculi producing infection, renal failure. Even when large stones, usually they become large, not small stones, staghorn calculi, and are seen on X-ray. As I said, they are all radio. 70% are radio opaque, only 30% are radiolucent, mostly uric acid calculi. A silent calculus presents due to secondary infection. As I said, may present late with the destruction of the renal parenchyma, uremia, and urosepsis. One of the important causes of urosepsis is a renal calculus disease with bilateral staghorn disease. Urosepsis is a very dangerous thing which may lead to multi-organ failure and death. So you have to be careful about this. Pain. Pain is a leading symptom in 75% of the patients. Renal pain, you should not call it as renal colic. Colic means a pain which gravitates from one place to other. This is fixed renal pain. So it is urinary colic and renal pain. So you have to differentiate. You cannot call it renal colic, though it is usually used. Renal colic is a misnomer. Kidney pain doesn't produce a colic. Urinary stone produces colic. Fixed renal pain, posteriorly in the renal angle, anteriorly in hypochondrium, are both worse on movement. This is the typical symptomatology of pain due to kidney calculus. May be associated with other symptoms like vomiting. If there is infection, fever could be there. So that's how a patient presents. So this presentation can be due to pain or infection. Hematuria may cause your attention to this to be initiated. And then you find renal calculi. Always, if there is a renal calculus, what you have to do is to see if the patient has fever, urine examination to rule out urinary infection and hematuria. And if there are bilateral renal calculi, you have to see the renal parameters, how the kidneys are functioning. If the patient is a diabetic, all the more dangerous because infection, obstruction, diabetes is a very horrible thing. So when a patient presents with fixed renal pain, you have to think of one stone in the kidney or kidney infections as such, you have to rule out. This is urinary colic. As I said, if the stone comes down the pelvic junction, kidney stone forms in the callus, comes down the pelvis. If there is a small stone, less about 5 mm or less than that, it can come through the pelvic junction and then grow. It causes stone, when it moves, produces severe pain. Kidney stone doesn't move because it's very much localized in the pelvis. Whereas the uric stone moves down because of the uric peristalsis and movement due to urine production. So depending on this, it produces severe pain. The background of continuous pain if there is already there. radiates to groin, penis, scrotum, or labium as the stone passes down. Severity of pain is not related to size. That's another thing you have to remember. For a urticoid patient typically holds his loin, says that there's a severe pain, waxing and waning, totally disappears for a moment, then again starts. Severe, associated with visceral symptoms like vomitings, diarrhea, vomitings, fever, urinary tract infection, and hematuria. So, when a patient presents with urinary colic symptoms like this, first thing is you have to treat the symptoms by giving an analgesic, parenteral analgesic. And if he has vomitings, you have to give them IV fluids. But IV fluids must not be given very fastly because, again, produce increases urine production and causes pain, aggravates pain. So you give a smooth muscle relaxant because the pain is due to ureteric peristalsis. If you inhibit ureteric peristalsis, the pain also comes down. So that's what you have to do if there is stone. Most invariably associated with hematuria, micro or macroscopic hematuria. You have to do a microscopic examination to see differentiate between infection and hematuria anyway, you have to do. There may not be any physical signs except some tenderness in the loin or in the guarding, not rigidity, guarding. Rigidity of lateral abdominal wall, but not of the rectus muscle. So that is only rigidity of the muscles, not board like this or like peritonitis, but there is some rigidity or guarding. When the patient is in pain, in between is free, you may not find any symptoms. Percussion of the kidney may be the stab of pain because of hydronephrosis. The stone is blocking the kidney, main ureter. It produces hydronephrosis and a tap over the kidney may produce pain. And swelling of the loin due to complication like pyonephrosis is also a way of presentation. Hematuria is usually there, but bleeding is usually microscopic. Pyuria, infection, it is there associated, there can be pyuria. As I said, if there is an obstructed system, it is dangerous. Pressure builds up in the collecting system and organisms injected into circulation may cause septicemia, as in urosepsis. Mechanical irritation of stone on urothelium produces also pyuria. Sterile pyuria is one of the causes, reasons for stone. Aortic stone may produce some pyuria even in the absence of infection. That is called sterile pyuria. So that's why it is pyuria, you have to culture and then find out if there is infection. And what do? You have to diagnose if there is pain due to stone or anything like that. Previously, when you did not have CT scan and ultrasound, you used to depend on only radiography, X-ray, KUB. Plain X-ray, kidney, ureter, bladder, region, film, KUB film. Kidneys are at the level of L. You have to take the film from T12 to pelvis to include all of the kidneys. L1, L2, L3 are the kidneys, so we had to take that. But not all radio-opaque shadows are stones. A calcified mesenteric lymph node also appears as a stone. Gallstones are concretions in the appendix. Gallstones are very frequently confused with renal stones. If the pain is on the right side and there is a gallstone as well, what you have to do is to take a lateral film of the X-ray. Gallstones are very much anterior, close to the anterodonal wall, whereas kidneys are very close to the spine. So renal calculus impinges on the spinal column, whereas gallstones are anteriorly placed near to the anterodonal wall. That's how you differentiate calculus on the right side from a gallstone. Tablets are foreign bodies also in the GIT appearance. Flibolis appearance stones. Ossified tip of L3 is another differential diagnosis. Calcific tuberculosis lesions of the kidney and calcified adrenal gland, these are all differential diagnosis of a radio opaque shadow in the plain X-ray KUB. Then ultrasound. Ultrasound is one which we do very commonly to see if there is a stone. But non-contrast enhanced CT scan is the investigation of the present day. They say you have to take a non-contrast enhanced CT scan in the casualty to diagnose calculus. And another differential diagnosis in patients having pain in the right iliac fossa, urologists are often asked to differentiate between appendix and aortic stone. Appendix is entirely a clinical diagnosis, is tenderness in the McBurney's point. And a stone appears in the ultrasound or renal calculus. So you cannot mistake both. Appendix is diagnosed on a different way altogether by taking total count and all. Mainstay for acute urinary colic in casualty setup is the enhanced CT scan, non-contrast enhanced for diagnosis. Previously, we used to follow it up with when we want to do something, we want to know the function on the side. So excretory urography, intravenous urogram. But intravenous urogram should not be done when the patient is in colic, because that produces a non-visualization of the kidney that side, wrongly interpreted as non-functioning kidney. So when there is an acute obstruction, there is shock kidney, that is called shock kidney, and it is not visualized normally. So it should not be done at the time of acute colic, but later on when the pain subsides, you can do that. This is one to study the effect of the kidney on the sides of stone, and also to know the function of the stone on the opposite kidney, normal kidney. So we are discussing only the bare investigations which are necessary to confirm. So, then biochemical investigations are done usually for all these patients, but special tests are done for recurrent stone formers. Serum calcium measured fasting on 3 occasions on normal calcium diet to exclude hyperparathyroidism. CBC, blood urea and serum creatinine are known to study renal function. Uric acid levels are also studied if they are high or low. Serum electrolytes, urine cultural sensitivity are done routinely for all these things, all the patients with characteristics. 24-hour urine collection and study of urine, 24-hour urine is done for urate, calcium and phosphate for recurrent stone formers. And if there is suspicion, it also must be screened for cysteine. And one important biochemical investigation is you have to study any stone that is passed. People, calcuria, it is called. Passage of stone in the urine is called calcuria. If patient passes a stone, you have to analyze it to find out the chemical composition, wherein you get a very good idea. What is the management? The heading, surgical treatment, don't consider it now, it come later. Always majority of the stones, small stones are managed conservatively only. Calcuria of less than 0.5 centimeters spawns spontaneously unless impacted in some areas, some oxalate stones. Infection in the upper urinary tract, obstructed by stone, requires urgent surgical intervention. But now they're not being done. There is double J stent is passed to overcome the obstruction. And stent, urethric stent is passed so to relieve the obstruction and all. That's it. Emergency treatment for a severe colic with infection. Pain, fever, vomitings, hematuria, all these patients with these symptoms should be admitted for observation and treated. They cannot be sent home like that because the complications can be there if the patient presents with pain and fever. Antibiotics for the urinary infection, analgesics, bed rest, and parenteral IV fluids. As I said, you cannot vigorously give. At one time, the hydrotherapy was being followed. This is a stone, give him a lot of fluids and inject Lasix so that there is diuresis and stone is formed. But as I said, it can be formed fast, but it can also cause severe hydronephrosis and complications. Then, when should you operate for stone? Should you operate or not? Calcuria cannot be passed on its own. It is a big stone, always needs intervention. The more than 1 centimeter, 1.5 centimeters, usually in the kidney, it usually doesn't pass. And also it doesn't pass through the ureteric orifice in the bladder, which allows up to 5 to 8 millimeters only. So such stones may need operative intervention by various modalities which we see. Most of the calculi can be treated by minimal access surgery techniques. Ureteric stenting for obstruction and modern methods of stone removal include percutaneous nephrolithotomy, extracarpal shockwave lithotripsy. We are talking about the kidney stones. Previously, there is a stone causing a pelvis, renal pelvis. We used to do an open operation. open pylolithotomy. The stone is in the pelvis, it is called pylolithotomy. We used to do that. And it extends into the calluses also, we used to do an extended pylolithotomy, removing that. Staghorn calculus we asked to remove by extended pylolithotomy. Later on, for stones, extracorporeal lithotripsy has come, wherein you blast the stone from outside and it is pulverized to be passed later. Then percutaneous nephrolithotomy, percutaneous access to kidneys has come. Then PCNL, percutaneous nephrolithotomy, is being done. So percutaneous nephrolithotomy, PCNL, percutaneous nephrolithotomy, started with big instruments first. Gradually it is coming down to mini PCNL, wherein small instruments are used to puncture the kidney. Kidney is punctured by means of a placement of a hollow needle into the renal system and dilatation of the tract and putting some ampulla sheath to maintain the dilatation and visualize the stone by a nephroscope and destroy the stone, I mean rather treat the stone by means of electrohydraulic lithotripsy or laser lithotripsy, whatever may be the mechanism. Small stones are grasped under vision and they are excited and like that. Larger stones are fragmented by ultrasound, laser or electrohydraulic probe and removed in pieces. Aim is to remove all fragments. Nephrostomy drainage to compress the system allows repeated access if it is required if the stone fragments are there. It can be combined with ESL for Staghorn calculi. Extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy, one disadvantage found was recurrence, many the hard stones cannot be blasted. Though it looks very interesting to that patient lies down and doesn't require anything to do and the stone is blasted. Many stones do not break, may require some other procedure. That's why it has gone, initially when it was found, it was panacea for all stones. Later on, it is not so popular now compared to PCNL. You see now how PCNL is done.
Say this. Step-by-step description of the operative technique. The operation begins with a standard puncture.
As I told you, this puncture to get access to the pelvic calcium system.
Is placed in the loin.
See that?
Patient in the prone position. The desired cane.
This is done with the patient in prone position. Right? Puncture.
Escapes outside. 0.032 size guide wire is inserted.
Then after putting the needle into the calcium system, a guide wire is passed so that the track is retained.
Over the guide wire.
Then over the guide wire. Gradual dilatation of the track is done.
8 French Teflon dilator.
Right. This is
followed by 11 French Teflon dilators are used.
These Teflon dilators are used to dilate the track up to the size of the nephroscope we are using.
After the Teflon dilator is removed, the UMP sheath is advanced over the
sheath. Nephroscope sheath is passed into the kidney directly through a lower calyx guard puncture track. Of course, this requires a lot of expertise and training. Yes. Endourology needs a lot of training and expertise. You have to do a number of cases to be proficient in the cause.
The UMP sheath has a side port that connects to a very thin tube that runs inside parallel to the lumen. The inner end.
You are seeing that nephroscope with another channel to pass the lessing. This is to visualize the stone.
Fits into the inner sheath. This 6 French sheath has one port for irrigation and the other port.
The discussion about mini PCNL, but the same thing is done with the bigger scopes also.
The telescope is placed in the UMP sheath.
See
the how system
the stone is seen.
The stone disintegration
directly. It is seen directly.
High energy, low frequency setting.
See how
the stone
it is
disintegrated.
Laser stone is
2 millimeter
broken into pieces.
Unlike RIRS, we do not want to disintegrate the stone into sand particles.
See, that's how the stone is blocked and stone fragments come out of the sheath.
Fragments are removed by injecting saline from the side.
See, just wash out, it comes out. You need to put in forceps and take these fragments.
And the fragments get sucked into the UMP sheath.
Right.
We do not have to use baskets or crossbows.
Small fragments don't require any mechanical removal. They just come out on washing. So see the fragmented stones which are there, which we have brought. Right?
This is how the thin saline jet would look like. Let me show you how the whirlpool effect looks like. This is the view within the pelvic alliteration system obtained with the help of a flexible urethral screw. When the thin jet of saline is in.
See, you have seen how PCNL is done live. This is a pictorial thing wherein you see that it is passed into the kidney and the stone broken and nephrostomy. So what are the complications? Or hemorrhage, when you puncture the kidney, calcium system of the kidney, there can be bleeding because of the intricate vascular structure in the kidney. Within the kidney itself, there are arcuate arteries and very closely, many arteries are there in the neck of the calyx and something like that. If you perforate, then there will be torrential bleeding. Perforation in the collecting system, you cannot sometimes may puncture pelvis directly, which is not, should go through only calyx, not this. The perforation of the colon or pleural cavity is one, if you want to do puncture at a higher level, these things happen, not for normal. As we are talking about, non-surgical treatment is extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy. Calculus is bombarded with shockwaves of sufficient energy. Fragmentation of stone happens and fragments pass down the ureter. So this may also cause ureteric colic, and sometimes they get blocked in the ureter. That's called stenosis, a blocked road, which we require again an intervention like stenting. A stent is placed to prevent obstruction by fragments of larger stones. And large stones are removed ureteroscopically. If stones are not passed down, that's the problem with extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy. Then we had to do ureteroscope and remove it. Clearance depends on consistency and site of the stone. Where the stones are there in the kidney, lower calyx, upper calyx, and others. Then now, the order of the day is a minimally invasive surgical management. You have seen how kidney can be approached from above by puncture, percutaneous nephrolithotomy. And then the another important thing is mini percutaneous nephrotomy, wherein using very small sized instruments. Now, retrograde intrarenal surgery has come into. You pass a flexible ureteroscope directly into the renal pelvis and then pulverize stone in the various calyceals. And endoscopic combined retrograde intrarenal surgery is another latest thing, wherein this intrarenal surgery is helped by endoscopic percutaneously also. These are now stones are managed not by open operation, but mostly by these conditions. So suppose you have to know about this because they are in your textbook. Surgical treatment, as I said, it is pyelolithotomy, extended pyelolithotomy, and there is an extension into the renal nephrolithotomy, can even incise in the kidney tissue and remove it. The approach is through lumbar approach, wherein vascular pedicles are identified and be ready. Ureter is identified, traced up to the renal pelvis, and you see the pelvis is on the posterior aspect of the kidney. Relation of the artery vein, it is posterior. Then you have to identify the renal pelvis, make an incision and remove the stone. That is pyelolithotomy. Extended pyelolithotomy is you dissect the hilum, intrarenal pelvis. If the pelvis is dissected to approach the calyces and remove it. Extended pyelolithotomy. So pyelolithotomy is for stones in the renal pelvis. An incision in the long axis directly on the stone in the renal pelvis. Stone is removed without fragmentation. So most of the people will say stone treatment is perfect with this pyelolithotomy only, wherein you remove entire stone, there are no fragments, no chances for recurrence. But think of the morbidity in open operations. Always the minimally surgical procedures are preferred to open surgery. Now the surgery for stones, pyelolithotomy has come down drastically. Very rarely it is being done. In the absence of infection, pelvic infection is closed. Pelvis is closed usually without any nephrotomy or anything like that. If there is sepsis, stone with sepsis, pyonephrosis, then you do a drainage procedure like nephrostomy. Extended parotidectomy is the plane between renal sinus and the collecting system is developed to avoid major vessels. So this is the open surgery wherein this is the incision in the pelvis. Stone is being removed, Stagon, these are the calluses. So renal sinus is dissected. This is extended by low lithotomy. Nephrolithotomy is for one complex calliculate branching into the calluses. Incision into the renal parenchyma to clear the kidney. So when adhesions from previous surgery are present in the pelvis, you may have to do a nephrolithotomy, direct incision. And posterior and parallel to Brodel incision, which is supposed to be avascular. So this can be done nephrolithotomy for Sagan calculatively. And partial nephrectomy is indicated rarely when the stone is in the outermost calyx, there's infected, damage to the adjacent parenchyma, then that portion of the kidney can be removed. And nephrectomy is reserved for the kidneys destroyed by obstruction infection. And particularly in xanthogranulomatous spinal nephritis, another condition which is a short note later on, we'll talk about that. So if the stone has destroyed the kidney, is a bag of pus, and stone removal doesn't do any good to the patient, you remove it. It's only a last resort. And an interesting thing is bilateral renal calculi. Patient presents with bilateral renal calculi. What you should do? Kidney with better function is treated first. Then immediately, opposite kidney is also operated. Maybe after 6 weeks, or you can wait up to 2 to 3 months. Silent bilateral Staghorn calculi in the elderly, suppose an 80-year-old person, you diagnose Staghorn calculi, I personally feel that they can be left, if there are no complications like infection and other things, they can be left on prophylactic urinary antibiotics. But now, the tendency, because of the armamentarium has increased, the energy sources have increased, the tendency is to operate on every stone. Patient should maintain high fluid intake. How to prevent recurrence? Many of these people present with recurrence. So you exclude metabolic factors by investigations which you have already discussed. Serum calcium, hyperparathyroidism, uric acid, high uric acid, you have to reduce that. 24-hour urinary urate, calcium and phosphate are measured like cysteine. Based on this, you give dietary advice. Drink plenty of water fluids to keep the urine dilute and maintain the pH, alkaline pH. So dietary advice is not usually helpful in avoiding stone recurrence in people who have a balanced diet. Plenty of oral fluids, 3 to 4 liters. Avoid calcium-rich diet, excess of milk products, oxalate-rich diets. That includes your soft drinks, cola drinks also. And green leafy vegetables are all high in oxalate. So you have to maintain a balance of all these things. So you should allow, give them not to take in excess. Then we come down to uterine calculus. As I said, most of single small stones pass spontaneously less than 5 millimeters. They are present with uterine colic. Impaction causes severe pain, hematuria, and sometimes they have to be differentiated from acute appendicitis and acute cholecystitis on the right side. So you see, this is the pelvis and stone, pelvic junction coming down. So this is one part where stone can get impacted. Then crossing the iliac artery. Crossing the iliac artery is narrowed in. That also can be blocked. This is juxtaposition to vas deferens and blood regurgitation where it crosses. And entering the bladder and ureteric orifice. Ureteric orifice is a narrow portion waiting if the stone may be there. If the stone is impacted in the terminal ureter, then you can have associated bladder symptoms also. Patient can have severe dysuria, and sometimes there can be retention of urine also, depending on this. So how are they diagnosed? By plain X-ray, ultrasound scan, spiral CT, non-contrast CT, and then if there are any terminal uterine jetting uteric orifice, we do a cystoscopy and retrograde uterography. So what is the treatment? Analysis first, give him pain relief, because pain itself, severe pain can cause a lot of complications. And usually, as I said, if you can wait, patient and doctor should have patience to wait. Then many small stones are passed off normally. Otherwise, there is intervention by means of ureteric stenting and removal of the stone. Repeated attacks of pain and the stone is not moving. You have taken X-ray, treated considerately, stone is not moving. That means it is impacted because of the nature of the arthritic calculus as such. Stone is enlarging and it is obstructing the kidney. That means, you see, hydronephrosis increasing. Urine is infected. Stone is too large to pass. Stone obstructing solitary kidney or bilateral obstruction. Bilateral uric obstruction due to calculi is produces calculus anuria. Anuria, it produces anuria. Calculus anuria is an emergency, urological emergency. You have to at least clear one stone of the calculi and immediately operate on the opposite side. So calculus anuria due to a bilateral obstruction, or if there is only one kidney, if it is blocked, it can produce anuria. So that is due to that, calculus anuria. So what do you do to the uric calculi? Endoscopic stone removal by means of basketing. Previously, we used a lot of basketing. Uric metartomy, if it is just impacted at the level of the uric orifice. And uric stenting, what does the uric stenting do? It relieves the obstruction and pain relief. When the foreign body is in the ureter, ureter dilates. So after 2-3 weeks, when you remove this uric stent, and stone can be passed because of the increased size of the ureter. And ureteroscopy can be done to remove all these stents. One is electrohydraulic, laser, ultrasound, lithotripsy in situ. And open surgery, again, uretrolithotomy, which is not being done nowadays at all. All the stones are managed, considered by other methods like ureteroscopic stone removal. So this is the old Narmia basking. Basket is passed behind the stone, opened, and stone gets included in the basket and remove it. Now you see the modern way of removing the stones. Ureterorhinoscopy, URS. See, it is under the spinal anesthesia. Initially, you do a cystoscopy examination to see the interior of the bladder, identify the uretric orifices, and do a retrograde pyelogram. See, this retrograde pyelogram to delineate the ureter. This, what you are seeing is a catheter being put into the uretric orifice to inject the dye. This is a retrograde uretrogram. See, dye will be injected. You will see the dye. See how the ureter is getting filled up. And the pelvical system also gets filled up. Right? This is the pelvical system. And then you pass guide wire into the ureter to bypass the stone. Stone is bypassed in the ureter. See, that is guide wire. Then this is balloon dilator to dilate the uterovesical junction so that ureteroscope can be passed. The other way of doing it is balloon dilatation of the uretic orifice. The uretic orifice is dilated so that the ureteroscope can be passed easily. Some people see that they are seeing the interior. There is a rigid ureteroscope. See, that is how the ureter appears. When you see into the ureter looks like that. And it is passed up through the stone. Fluoroscopy in to visualize this thing as we have done. And also endoscope, endo camera and CRM also are there to identify the stone if there is a need. See, that's the uretic stone. You can see the stone directly. And then this is the laser fiber with which the stone is blasted. Lithotripsy it is called. It is blasted. Stone is blasted. Previously, we used to cut on the ureter, remove the stone, put a stent and close the ureterlithotomy, whatever may be position. Now it's not required. Laser lithotripsy has taken this management very easy to do now. But of course, you have to remember it requires costly equipment, costly infrastructure, and training to do this thing. See how the stone is blasted. So this is a ureteroscope radiograph which you are seeing in X-ray only. Then we will come to bladder calculi. Bladder calculi primary can develop in the sterile urine. seen in poor children and adolescents. As I said, vitamin A deficiency in these people causes desquamation and anidus for stone formation. We used to get many pediatric age group patients with big vesical calculi, sometimes even mimicking fetal head, such big stones. We had to deliver these stones by means of an outlet forceps sometimes. Most bladder calculi are seen in men. This is secondary calculi also can form in bladder due to infection, outflow obstruction, impaired bladder emptying due to other causes, and foreign body like tip of the Foley catheter or double diastate, something like that. The stone can form over that. And also sometimes operations done in and around, some sutures can get involved in the bladder and it can form over the suture line also. That's why whenever you do operations on the bladder, always you should use absorbable suture material that gets absorbed. If it remains non-absorbed, stones can form over that. So most vesical calculi are mixed calculi. Oxalate, you see, type of stone here, big stone, slow growing, moderate, solitary, uneven surface. That's why it produces hematuria more. Calcium oxalate, we have discussed already in the renal calculi. Uric acid, round or oval, smooth. And these calculi can form an ileostomy. Ileostomy is an operation wherein the intestine is brought out. And bladder outflow obstruction is an important cause of multiple calculi in the bladder, as I said. Cystine calculi can also occur in the formed from the kidney and passed down. Triple phosphate are infection sources, as we have discussed, in the kidney itself. Ammonium, magnesium, calcium phosphate. Infected urine is there with urea spreading organisms. They grow very rapidly. Dirty white and chalky, maybe a nucleus of other types. And sometimes all the foreign body, stones forming on the foreign body are also triple phosphate stones. Usually moves freely in the bladder and gravitates to the lowest part of the bladder. That's why there is stone impaction with severe pain occurring in the strangury. As long as bladder is full, stone is buttressed. Once the bladder empties, stone falls on the trigone and causes severe pain referred to the tip of the penis. Sometimes there is a diuretic lump in the bladder because of outflow obstruction. Stone can also form in a diuretic lump. Stone analysis frequently reveals triple phosphate stones. As I said, multiple calculi are a suggestion of distal obstruction. Hematuria, few drops of bright red blood at the end of micturition. Terminal hematuria, it is called. Terminal hematuria with severe pain referred to the tip of the penis is an indication. So in children, whenever they pass urine, they catch the penis and cry out. That is the reason. Interruption of urinary stream. Stone can block suddenly the bladder neck and there can be interruption. Internal meatus blockade and sudden interruption of urinary stream. This is very typical. If a patient says, I've been passing urine, suddenly as it is blocked, that means there's a possibility of a vesical calculus blocking the internal meatus. Urinary infection, sometimes undiagnosed stones can present with urinary infection only. And once you investigate for that, calculi can be found. And when you examine physically stones, even though they are big, they may not be palpable. But if there is outflow obstruction, chronically distended bladder can be found. Very large calculi is palpable vaginally, not abdominally. Previously, vesical stones used to be removed through rectum. They used to remove it through rectum and vagina as it is. But that used to lead to fistulae and then this is given up. This is history of medicine, not contemporary medicine. Urine examination to put microscopic hematuria, examination for infection, and stone is seen on plain X-ray if it is. Most of these things are radiopaque, so they are seen. An ultrasound, small stones may be diagnosed in ultrasound. Imaging of the entire urinary tract to exclude an upper tract stone. As I said, primary calculi come from above. So you see that there is a radiopaque density in the renal pelvis. It is not usually with an erect posture, it falls down to this level. Since this X-ray is taking a lying down posture, it is seen higher above. So this says it can be a vesical calculus. But a vesical calculus should be confirmed by cystoscopic examination Not all shadows like this are vesicular calyx. See this? There is a big rounded opaque shadow in the bladder area, but this is only a calcified uterine fibroid, not bladder calculus. So you have to confirm presence of vesicular calculus by doing a cystoscopic examination. So vesicular calculi, treatment of vesicular calculus per se is important, but also you have to think of reasons for calculi formation, secondary calculi. Cause of stone should be sort of, as I said, bladder outer obstruction or any neurogenic elements or diabetic causes, which leads to incomplete bladder emptying. Nearly all stones can be dealt with endoscopically nowadays. Previously, we used to do cystolithotomy, that's a standard operation, wherein you approach the bladder, cut it open, remove the stone, close the bladder, putting a catheter and a supraorbital cystoscopic tube. These used to, the, all the stones, infected stones, used to lead to a lot of infection problems. So now, all stones are endoscopically managed, even in children. Minimally invasive technique, blind lithotrite is not done. You previously used to pass a blind lithotrite and crush the stone. But now everything is done on under vision only. Optical lithotrite and with energy sources of electrohydraulic holmium laser and ultrasound probes, these stones are crushed, pulverized and made into a powder to be washed out. The advantage is it can be washed out. Multiple washes can be given under vision and all calculi extracted. Stone punch, we are historic, we used to do. And another percutaneous method is also there through percutaneous nephrostomy, using the percutaneous nephrostomy, and again using laser. Periurethral instrumentation cannot be done in the stricture, so it has to be done through perabdomen only. And contracted bladder cannot be done because it has to be, bladder has to be distended. In a very large stone, if there is no space to work, it can be difficult. Ultrasound is only for small stones. Laser lithotripsy is the most commonly done in even in childhood. Children, a track, like a track is established in kidney, a track is established into the bladder, dilated, and stone is crushed with under vision. So this is a blind lithotripsy which used to be used previously. This used to be passed per urethra into the bladder, stone in caught in between and crushed. So used a lot of complications were there. Now this is endoscopically, directly see the stone and used by ultrasound probe or other things. Percutaneous lithotripsy is a needle inserted into the bladder and guide wire introduced. Alkane metal dilators dilate the tract. Ampler sheath is a sheath which is followed, I mean which is fixed so that the instrument can be passed. And that can be lased. Lased means using laser, it can be powdered. So it can be done in childhood, children also, adults, everybody. But in adults, when there is a stone, you have suspect that there is an obstruction by means of a prostate obstruction or other obstructions, you have to rule out stricture, bladder neck obstruction, then only treat. Otherwise, the fistula will not heal. Right? This is about management of renal calculus. This is not just kidney, ureter, and bladder. So it's an important thing of renal failure, and you have to manage that. Right? Then, any doubts about this? Any questions? I think the attendance has improved to 123. That's good. Right? To start with, it was 86. Any questions? There are no questions, we'll end it here. Okay. Yes, there's one question. Role of nephrostomy in PCNL. Yes, the stones have come out and there's any complication, you do nephrostomy tube by tube, drain it out. If you want a relook operation, you have to keep the track open, you put a nephrostomy tube. So you know PCNL is putting a hole in the kidney and seeing it. By putting a nephrostomy tube, you are keeping that hole patent for any renal surgery or any fragments to come down you put the tube. That is why you have to do a nephrostomy after PCNL. There is a big discussion at the super specialty level whether you are required to do a PCNL, I mean nephrostomy or no nephrostomy. So many variations are there, but there is always an advantage in putting a tube if there is suspicion of leaving some fragments or you want to do a relook operation. Best thing is advice you can give to a patient a stone is drink a lot of water. Plenty of oral fluids is a standard thing advice to be given to the patients. I used to keep water bottles in my clinic. Show them I drink this much of water. You also have to drink. Mostly 1 hour after taking food because the maximum constituents are in circulation at that time are likely to be filtered. And also during night. During night, many of the people don't wake up to take water. Isn't that? So the urine gets concentrated. That's when the stone grows. So usually when lying down in the night, stone grows in the night. You lie down, dependent area, urine doesn't drain properly, urine is concentrated. So those are the conservative methods of treatment. In the next classes, we'll try to take certain of the short notices given for you in the examination. I'll try to cover some other things. Right? Okay then.